is CNN.
And 11:30. I'm Aaron Burnett here in Mobile, Alabama, and the cruise ship Triumph, the Carnival cruise ship Triumph. You're looking at a live picture right now. We have a helicopter flying over, so you're able to see it. It's about 2.21 miles exactly from where I'm standing right now at the port in Mobile, Alabama. And we just heard from Carnival Cruise Lines that that ship is going to dock between 10:30 and 11:30 Eastern time, but it could take 3 to 4 hours from them before people on that ship, more than 4,200 of them, are actually going to be off the ship. And joining me now is Karen Jackson, her husband Travis, along with Doug Briscoe. They're family members of a jazzercise group on board the ship. And your daughter Carley is on board the ship. We're going to talk to her in a moment, and your wife Angie. Tell me what happened when Angie told you this happened. What are some of the stories she told you that really stuck with you?
Well, when she first called me, she called me Sunday night. I'd heard about it, and I didn't really believe it, and because it was her first cruise. And she called
me. First cruise.
It was her first cruise. Yeah, she called me Sunday night, and she said, hey, the ship's broke down. She was in good spirits, you know, light mood. And then she called me Monday about 1 o'clock, and she said, I asked her, what have you eaten? Because we didn't know. We hadn't talked to her. And she said, yes. She said, I had an onion sandwich and a bottle of water. She said, but, you know, we're going to make do. You know, she said, it's a bad situation. She said, they'll get us going.
So she's got a good attitude. I know there were 11 people from where you're from in Paris, Texas. You all drove more than 10 hours to come here and pick up Angie and Carley. Carly's on the phone. And Carley, what's it been like? I mean, You're able to teach jazzercise. You're ready for almost anything. But what's it been like over the past couple days?
It's been a little rough. I mean, you know, without some toilets, I mean, that's always going to be rough on a big old boat. But it's been okay. I mean, everyone's kind of come together on the boat, and we've been really safe, and we've never felt like we've been, you know, in any kind of trouble. I mean, or danger. You know, we've just kind of come together as like a big old family, and everybody's doors are open, you know, letting people, you know, sleep on other balconies, you know. So, I mean, it's been rough, but the crew has been amazing, and they have been over backwards just to do whatever, you know, that we needed. So, so that's been amazing. But, sorry, they're announcing something.
Your mother is sitting here sort of looking a little shell-shocked, Karen. Are you, and you're tearing up.
I'm sorry, they're announcing something on the boat right now.
Your 20-year-old daughter.
Seeing her picture on the screen, I think.
Yeah.
Got to both of us. We've seen the picture. We just see it there with the ship. It's pretty
real.
To
see her smile.
Yes.
Exactly.
Well, Carley, what are they announcing? Have you heard the full announcement?
Oh my goodness, we see land. That's always me. No, I wasn't even listening to the announcement. I should have. We went out on our balcony. Oh, that's all it was. It's just people and needing to receive travel information. That's what the announcement was. So.
Yeah, she's having a good time with this.
Okay. And have you been able to clear customs and all of that is set, Carley?
I'm sorry, what did you say?
I was just saying, did you clear customs already, or have they not done that?
Yeah, that went so smooth. It was amazing. It didn't take any time. You know, they gave us the form ahead of time, and, you know, they called us by floor, and then we all went through, and yeah, that was really good. It's like really smart to have them come aboard and do that. That way it would make the disembarkment so much faster for us.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it went really good, so.
Well, all right. Carley, thank you very much, and thanks very much to all of you. And I know it's going to be an emotional and special night for you. The headline, of course, Donnie, from Carley was, "We see land, we see land."
I'm back with the panel, Pat Kiernan, Ricky Kleeman, and Stephanie Rule. Stephanie, you know, it's very...
2020. Troubled waters. The triumph that wasn't.
We thought we were going to die for a little while.
We're there as passengers finally disembark early this morning. Stranded for days. Garbage and toilets backed up. Forced to sleep in tents on the poop deck.
5 days, one flush.
No electricity, no air conditioning, and not enough answers.
Clearly, we failed.
So tonight, we try to ask the tough questions.
I wonder if you could take a few more questions, like, do you really?
What keeps happening on these ships, and who should pay? High and dry. Plus, the Costa Concordia, a year later, still dead in the water, while victims try to rebuild their lives and recover their loved ones still missing.
You just can't take a pill and get over it.
And whatever happened to the so-called chicken of the sea, the captain who went MIA when the lights went out?
There were no women and children first. Ladies, you're on your own.
Ghost Ship and Cruise Ship Confidential. What's really going on in the cabin next door? What do staff insiders say?
All the action is below the waterline. The average crew deck makes a sorority house look like a nunnery.
The secret underground of sex and liquor below deck.
If there's an empty cabin, that'll be the cabin where everybody goes to have sex.
What happens when you're trapped by rough seas, rough passengers, and even rougher germs? Troubled waters. Here now, David Muir.
Good evening, and so many families, so many couples just getting home tonight after days trapped at sea on that Carnival cruise ship, Triumph. The real triumph, though, those passengers simply getting through it all, the so-called cruise from hell, finally docking in Alabama. 5 days after a terrifying engine fire knocked out power and turned that ship into what some called a floating petri dish. There was suffering, fortunately not the casualties of last year's Costa Concordia, but all of it does raise serious questions. And so tonight here, we put a microscope on the industry as a whole. Why was an ultimate rescue so late in coming? And were the apologies too little, too late? Matt Gutman, on this from the start, was on that dock getting answers.
The thousands of stranded passengers knew their ordeal was finally over. And this morning, they came pouring out of the crippled ship. It was an untriumphant return.
We get to go home.
Standing on, and in some cases, kissing terra firma for the first time in 8 days.
Yeah, you can talk to us. Come on over.
I'm speechless. It's just really great to finally be back in America and on land.
Some angry.
The doctor on the staff can excuse my French. He can kiss my...
It was the worst experience I've ever had. We thought we were going to die for a little while.
Others relieved.
I'm just happy to be alive. It's quite an ordeal, but we're here.
They ran, many wearing bathrobes against the cold, to plant kisses on loved ones, holding on to each other. By the hundreds, they were stuffed onto buses before they could even shower or even change their gritty clothes. Among the first out, Stephanie Stevenson and Rob Malum.
Hey!
Not just your regular cruisers. They were headed for the tropics for a reason, a romantic wedding at sea. He's in a tie, she's in white. But marital bliss would turn into maritime nightmare early on Sunday morning, 3 days into the cruise.
Looked over the side rail, and you could see the just billows and billows of smoke coming out of the top of the stack.
You scared?
I was pretty freaked out.
A fire had erupted in the engine room, and some passengers go into Titanic mode.
They said Alpha team to
attention,
the engine
attention,
room.
Attention, code Alpha engine room.
People take it upon themselves to strap on life jackets and scramble towards the lifeboats.
I saw the smoke. I knew good and well there was a good chance the ship would be sinking.
The fire had burned out the ship's main engines. The sparkling city on the sea, known as the fun ship you see in these Carnival ads, was now not much more than a 100,000-ton cork bobbing in the Gulf of Mexico. The electricity cuts out. Everything goes dark. Carley Jackson and Jody Adelhauser are jazzercise instructors from Paris, Texas.
All the power shut off at like once, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is like Titanic.
The lower decks fill with smoke, engulfing some of the cafeterias. They even see it billowing from the stack.
The smoke has gotten worse.
Then the air conditioning goes out. Still, the crew assures the passengers that everything is under control.
Nothing to worry about, folks. You can wait up on the Lido deck. It's really lovely out there.
An automated system extinguishes the fire, but the ship stays dead in the water. By Monday, 24 hours after the crisis began, Carnival decided to tow the ship not to nearby Mexico, but to Mobile, Alabama, because not everybody had passports with them. That added nearly 350 miles and an extra day of hardship for passengers.
I'm not liking that.
By this time, two other Carnival cruise ships had been diverted to deliver food and water to the hobbled vessel. Helicopters were also deployed carrying generators and other supplies on Wednesday.
They came and dropped off water and stuff, but that didn't stop babies from going hungry. That didn't stop other people from hoarding food.
Wow.
But despite their efforts, conditions aboard the Triumph were deteriorating fast. No electricity, not enough running water, and almost no cell phone service, leaving parents and loved ones on land frantic.
I just need to know that she's okay.
The ship, 300 yards long, equipped with every amenity, and now the more than 4,000 aboard could only communicate in snippets of text messages.
We're in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico.
36 hours into the crisis, no hot food, no hot water, no AC, and the ship was listing.
When we were leaning one way, it was kind of a little nerve-wracking.
Worst of all, backed up toilets. There was sewage everywhere.
Got one flush, one time.
5 days, one flush.
5 days, one flush.
For toilets, the ship handed out these red bags.
People were using the restroom in little red plastic bags and throwing them out into the hallway.
We were in shock. We were like, I'm not using a red bag.
The thing is you just don't eat. You just don't eat.
To not have to use the red bag.
Controlling the colon. You just don't eat.
We met a couple that we were talking to that said her husband was laying in bed and just the ceiling fell down on him full of
urine, feces, all of that.
Yeah.
The stench and heat driving people to camp out on the decks. They built tent cities out of bed sheets.
We've been shipwrecked for, I guess, 3 days now.
ABC News was the first to fly out over the ship on Wednesday.
You can tell how powerful the wind is, gusting at 25 miles an hour.
Those conditions bringing out the worst in some people.
They opened the bar one evening and gave away free drinks. And that was a really bad idea. There were people throwing things over the side of the ship, acting unruly.
And during the voyage, passengers did receive updates on the PA system as well as printed status updates, but Rob Mallon thinks that was another poor decision.
Somehow they managed to print us out little letters that they sent to our room.
Maybe they were using the emergency generator to supply printers instead of toilets.
Yeah.
Folks hoarding food, forcing others onto a diet of onion sandwiches.
What was the food situation like?
You had to stand in line for 3 hours to get a meal. And the first couple days it was the onion sandwiches.
But at least they were steadily, if slowly, being tugged back to the U.S. That's when Mike Padilla finally got through to his wife on the phone, anxiously waiting her return.
They think the tug line might have just broken.
Passengers say this should never have happened. Just last week, Carnival admitted that there was an electrical problem on the Triumph's previous voyage, but said there is no evidence at this time of any relationship between this previous issue and the fire that occurred on February 10th. This is the latest in a string of incidents involving cruise ships. Last year, the Costa Concordia capsized in Italy, killing 32 passengers. And in 2010, another Carnival ship, the Splendor, was stranded 4 days after another engine fire. Unlike the airline industry, there's no agency regulating the safety operations of cruise lines. Jim Walker is a maritime lawyer.
And unlike our U.S. aviation, commercial aviation fleet in the States that has the FAA that can oversee the industry and actually shut a fleet down if there's safety violations, there's no one looking out for the safety of passengers on ships relative to fires.
A spokesman for the cruise industry denies there's no regulation.
I know you can't talk to me, but is there anybody who can?
For 3 days, not a single Carnival exec appeared publicly until CEO Jerry Cahill spoke late Tuesday.
We pride ourselves in providing our guests with a great vacation experience, and clearly we failed in this particular case.
Carnival has offered the passengers a full refund, a voucher for another cruise, and $500, and it will cover travel expenses.
Oh my God,
it's degrading. Demoralizing. And then they want to insult us by giving us $500.
Since Sunday, ABC News has been requesting answers to questions about the ship's history of mechanical problems. No answer. They did hold 3 press conferences, but answered very few questions.
I'm sorry, Mr. Thornton, Matt Gutman from ABC News. Thank you for taking the time today. But I wonder if you could take a few more questions. Like, do you really? You're running away.
We've been trying to track down anybody
from Carnival to talk to us.
And the company's chief marketing officer, he also retreated.
We're on our way.
2 minutes.
But one thing that did go right in the end for Carnival was bringing that colossus of a ship up this narrow channel in darkness. And after 8 days at sea, the most precious of cargo delivered back to family members.
You guys gonna sleep tonight?
I'm gonna shower.
We're showering. We had our food, now just a long shower, long hot shower.
I really want to get home though.
And for the newlyweds, a delayed wedding banquet of burgers and fries.
This is gonna be the best hamburger ever.
Never was there a couple so happy to trade a cruise for a bus.
When we got on the bus, we went back and we flushed the toilet just to make sure it worked.
And two other notes tonight. It's your tax dollars that help pay the price of these rescues by the Coast Guard, leading some to ask tonight, should the cruise lines be paying more? And as for size, the Carnival Corporation owns nearly half the industry, 10 brands, 100 ships worldwide. The industry is still growing. ABC's own parent company, Disney, has 4 ships of its own. We'll be right back.
Next, the Costa Concordia, more than a year later, still stuck on its side. The images we can't forget, and survivors still reliving the nightmare.
I haven't slept.